Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, it's good to see everybody out here on this beautiful day. You know, it's really nice, a nice sunny day. You can actually watch your fingers develop frostbite now, the bright sunlight. So it's refreshing. You know, it's been quite a winter for us and quite a series of difficult snowstorms and ice and all kinds of things. But the reality is that we can never be defined by what's happening outside. We can only be defined by what's happening in our heart and in our lives. And that's what faith is all about. You know, faith is talked about all the time in churches. We talk about waiting for God, and then we ask ourselves, well, what are we waiting for? And what we're truly waiting for is not an answer to our problems. It's not an answer to our dilemmas. What we are truly waiting for is God's wisdom as to how to walk through this life. And that is what we celebrate. That we celebrate, we worship, we serve a God who is with us intimately and in every facet of our life. And so that is why we can begin this day, as we do each time the good folks of Salem gather, with this powerful affirmation: this is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Now, we do have a visitor this morning. We have a visitor from the East. Linda is here, and with some degree of trepidation and fear, I'm going to let, she has a couple announcements she'd like to make. You can actually come up here.
Up there, okay.
You're allowed to.
Can I stand here?
You can stand any place you would like, but we do have to be done here in an hour.
Well, I won't talk very long. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
I am here to invite all of you to Church of the Four Seasons next week. We are having a musical celebration, and as we share the Word of God. I apologize, I just wrote this before coming here, so I don't know all of it by heart yet. we will come alive featuring song and celebration and featuring some local talent. So I hope that next week you attend service here or go there, rest up, and then if you come here, rest up, and then come on over there, and we'll have a joyous time. And that's all I got right now, right?
Okay, very good.
Hey, you should have been up there longer.
11 o'clock.
You should have been up there longer. Now you got to
I know, you have to listen.
Absolutely true. And yes, you do have to listen to me. You know, as we walked in today, we carried with us a lot of burdens. And, you know, we talked about them earlier on this morning. But the reality is, the only way we can deal with those burdens and deal with those issues is knowing that we have the peace of Christ, and that peace comes from our relationship with God. So before we begin our service, let us offer to one another a sign of that peace.
Hey, everybody's here.
I feel like I'm in the spotlight.
That was short-lived, but impressive.
Well, we can say, hey, hey everybody.
Okay,
the more we talk, the less people.
Please stand and join me with the call to worship. Waiting for God's hand to touch our lives is difficult.
We cry out, we lament,
we begin to question.
Waiting for God is not a time of inaction or turning away.
It is a time of purposeful preparation to be guided by God's wisdom.
And to receive the strength and hope found in God's grace.
We rejoice and we wait in joy.
Please join us in our opening hymn, God Will Take Care of You, page 130. And we're doing verses 1, 3, and 4 with the introduction. It starts at 7.
Oh, 7. Yeah. About 6 o'clock. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, sorry, at 6.
Cooks need to be here at 6. The others, 6:30, 6:45 on Saturday morning. There's still tickets to sell. And I think that's it.
Sir.
I think we're pretty good on it.
We're pretty good with syrup. I know people have brought some in this morning,
yeah.
So I don't know.
I think we're pretty good with sugar-free. And bring the regulars in, that's fine.
Okay, it'll be good. And again, encourage everybody to attend, sign up to work. It is always a good time. It's always
bring a friend.
Bring a friend.
Or 10, or 12.
Or 10. Find me a friend so I can bring them, whatever. All right. Before we do joys and concerns, today our sanctuary candle, and as you know, that candle is always a sign of a light, either a celebration or a light in our life. The candle is a sign of those things in our life that give us life. What is life giving? And often it is in memory of a person. And today that candle is in memory of Steve Chopla, Karen and Stan's son who passed away. And one of the things, those of us who attended his memorial service, one of the things we all walked away with was the way in which his life was so impactful on other lives in terms of helping people understand faith in their life, helping people understand that faith is just a part of who you are, not something separate, not something confined to Sunday. He was an excellent musician, and in his music, he really lived a very real song of what it means to believe in God, very authentic. And so as we look at that light, I think we should be reminded that as in Steve's life, as in each of ours, we can indeed share what it means to have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And we can share it in a real way. No preaching, no platitudes, but what song do you live to share God with people? That's the question that we need to ask as we look at that light today. So let us celebrate his memory.
Yeah, today is his birthday. Would have been his birthday.
Thank you, yesterday would have been his birthday.
59 today.
So we want to celebrate his memory, and we also want to celebrate the legacy that lives on. So we want to keep the Chopla family in our prayers today in a very, very special way. And thank God for sharing Steve with us for too short of a time. All right. Also this morning, though, we do have some birthdays coming up this week. I know of one. Laura, do you know who has a birthday this week? Friday will be Laura's birthday, the 25th. She's forgetting things. That's all.
Oh, she's only 29.
That's right. No. So we want to celebrate her birthday on, I think it is the 25th, right? Friday the 25th. Also, I think, Kim, you have a birthday coming up this month on the 28th, right? Right, so you only celebrate like what, every 4 years or something? That's very good. So yes, actually she's only 13. Any other birthdays that I have forgotten about? All right, other joys this morning or other concerns we want to share? Any update on Johanna?
No, she's doing okay. She's
okay, I think I'm going to go see her with Charlotte tomorrow. That's what I understand. So.
You don't know yet.
What are you laughing at?
And we're talking about, you know, having, you know, stopped, you know, therapy, but she's going to try to talk, you know, say she needs more therapy because she goes home, she's going to fall again.
Right. Exactly. So we want Johanna to be guided by wisdom. Yes, absolutely.
And her blood pressure.
Adam.
Yes, Adam.
Luckily, we got to go this week to the Opera House.
Okay.
We've seen, what's her name?
Matilda.
Okay.
And it was good. About a little girl, you know, she was real smart, and nobody really appreciated her.
Right.
And it was a very nice play, and we've seen.
We saw Charlotte and Pam.
Oh, Pam? Okay.
They were both there because they, Pam had somebody in the play.
The granddaughter.
Pam's granddaughter is
and
extremely.
It was a very nice play, and we enjoyed it.
You know what? I will let them know you brought that up this morning. Thank you for doing that. That's awesome.
Well, she came walking around the corner, and we thought she was coming to say hello to us, right. Pam. And it turns out her granddaughter was right in front of us.
Oh,
she
wow.
She was coming to see her, not us.
Well, you know, people come to church. People come to church to see you and not me. So I don't know what that feels like. No, that's awesome. All right. Also today, yes, Lloyd.
Peggy is this coming week probably going for an MRI on her two knees and shoulder. She's been having a lot of pain, and hopefully they'll find something they can do for her. So okay. I pray that they can.
We will do that. And I think Roxanne's having an MRI Friday. Maybe you guys can carpool.
You can add me to the mix. I'm having one Wednesday.
Oh, okay, yeah.
We're going to Pinnacle. Anybody need a ride?
That's where I live.
All right. Also today, we want to keep the Wallace family in our prayers. Mike Wallace, who's been hospitalized, we want to lift that family up and keep them, pray that they know they are in God's care and also in the care of this congregation. Absolutely, without a doubt. We want to pray for June, and we want to pray that June will find the right placement for her recovery, her restoration, and a very special prayer for Terry, that she's June's daughter, that she'll be guided by wisdom and given the strength to do what she needs to do. And we want to pray for Emma and Jess. Jess had a rather nasty fall in the shower yesterday, and he's doing fine, no broken bones, just some staples in his head, unfortunately. But we want to pray that Emma and Jess know that they are so much a part of our family here, and so much a part of the Salem family, and that they'll be comforted by God's love. Anyone else this morning? My goodness, that's...
Well, I'm just glad to be back.
What?
We're glad to see you.
Glad to be back.
I'm glad I'm back.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, thanks for the warning. Yeah.
So what, the Lutherans didn't want you to stay?
They ran me out.
I thought so. All right, let's center ourselves in the presence of a God who already is fully aware of everything happening in all of our lives, and a God who walks with us every moment of our life. Living God, we come to you today and we celebrate. We celebrate the very gift of life. As we remember today, Steve Chopla, we rejoice that you shared him with us. And may his legacy be a light unto all people to live in faith, to live in hope, and to trust in your promises. We pray in a very special way for Johanna today, that you will guide her and continue to strengthen her, and may she find hope and be nurtured by your love. We pray for Peggy, for Roxanne, for Penny, as they undergo tests this week, that your wisdom will guide their caregivers, and that an answer will be found, and they'll be free of pain, free of suffering, that they may know that it is your hand that heals, it is your love that protects, and your love that nurtures. We pray in thanksgiving for the very gift of life as we celebrate birthdays. We celebrate Laura's birthday. We just thank you for her ministry, for her love, for her service. Celebrate Kim's birthday. We thank you for the witness of her life and all of the ways that she reveals your love in the way she walks the path you have chosen for her. We do pray in a special way today. We pray for the Wallace family, that Mike may know in your healing presence a certain strength, a certain peace. May he rest in the promises that you are a God who never abandons. You are a God who holds us tight at the deepest moments of our life, at moments of need. We pray for Chris in a very special way. We pray that you'll be comforted and sustained by your love, nurtured by your grace, and held in the light of your Son. We pray for June, and we pray for June today that she may feel the love of this congregation being lifted up to her right now at this moment. We pray for Terry, her daughter, that she'll be guided by your wisdom, and may they live in the light of your compassion, the light of hope. We pray for Jess. We pray for Emma. We pray that they will be strengthened in your presence, comforted by your love, and called to know that your promises are true and they will never be abandoned. We pray that they may find any help that they need, and your healing touch may be with Jess in a special way this week as he recovers from his injuries. We thank you for the beauty and celebration of the theater, of plays, for it is in the creative spirit that you are known. It is the creative life that we express joy and come together, and just communities coming together. And that is a way we celebrate, even though often we walk through some very, very difficult times. And we pray, of course, for this congregation. We pray that you will continue to open our hearts to how we may serve, open our lives to how we may love, and open our hands to how we may help. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
forgot one thing. I forgot Karen. She wanted to be added to the purse because she's having pain in her right shoulder.
Okay.
She's gonna have an x-ray and she's...
All right. We will pray for Karen. Say, Holy God, we lift Karen Choplin to you today. We pray that as she undergoes tests, there will be an answer found to her pain, and we pray that, your healing presence will grant her strength, will grant her comfort. Bathe her in your love, cover her in your peace, and may she walk in the light of your Son. Amen. Thank you. I'm sorry, I did forget all about that. Next time, though, just pass a note up to the front.
Yeah, actually, he's been scared.
It seems great.
Please join me in the prayer of confession, which can be found in your bulletin. Holy God,
in ancient days, our forebears waited for your hand to touch human history, to bring liberation, to secure a people, and to ensure true justice. We wait today as well. Yet in your Son, your promises were fulfilled, and your kingdom proclaimed for all eternity. You are a merciful God. Forgive us for those times when waiting to hear your voice leads us from your pathways and hardens our hearts. Renew us so that our hearts are prepared to receive your grace, be guided by your wisdom, and rest in your peace as revealed by your Son, our Lord. Send us forth to witness our dependence on your providential love. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, last week when we spent a time in silent prayer, the experience of God, the experience of God in a very special way, I ask you to think about a verse from the Psalm. And that verse was, great peace have they who love thy law. And now today, I want to continue that verse because I know Adam mentioned after the service, that is such a meaningful verse in Scripture. And it's one that we can all claim. But I'm not sure it's one that I ever fully understood until I started reflecting on it this week. Because the phrase we really need to focus on is great peace. Great peace have they who love thy law. But in each of our life, we need to answer the question, what does that peace mean? Now, I know when I used to recite that verse when I was in school, that to me would mean whatever problem I had that day was going to be taken care of. Whatever problem was going to go away. But then as I got older, all of a sudden the problems didn't go away. And I had trouble understanding that verse. I had trouble understanding what it meant or how it impacted my life. Because I didn't have my problems solved when I would recite that or meditate on that. And so today, as we experience God in the silence of our hearts and the silence of our minds, I want you to ask yourself, what does peace mean to you right now? And let God answer, not you. Because if we answer, we're going to answer from our human perspective as to what we want. Let God speak to you today as to what God wants for peace in your life. Amen. Interestingly enough, when we talk about that word peace, it is so misused, so misunderstood. When we talk about it in terms of our faith, I hope that we come to realize, and I still have come to realize this, that the peace they talk about in Scripture is a certain peace in our relationship with God. Then all other things seem to fall into place. So I would ask you to meditate on that verse this week. As we come to the end of the season of Epiphany, as we prepare to enter the season of Lent, that time of reflection and repentance and personal transformation, hopefully, think about peace with God and what that truly implies. We now join together in what we call our pastoral prayer. And the pastoral prayer is where we, as the Church of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ, remind ourselves of what our witness must be, remind ourselves of what we are called to do and how we're called to serve. Please respond, hear our prayer. Living God of enduring grace, may the Church of your Son be a place of justice, a place of hope, an advocate of peace, and a tireless worker for harmony among all peoples. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For this community, Salem United Methodist Church, may we continue our 178-year legacy of fellowship, of service, of love for those we serve, and hope for all who we touch. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For all who suffer, those names we have lifted today, those who suffer physically, those who suffer emotionally, those who suffer the bondage and the pain of addiction, that the Church of your Son may be a place of healing, of reconciliation, and of hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For our first responders, to know that the job they perform, the task they undertake, is indeed a sacred one, may they be protected by your love, guided by your wisdom, and held in your providential care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For our nation, to know your healing presence, to rise above our partisan differences, and to recognize that we are one in your love, one in unity by the power of your Spirit, and one in service to the work of building your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We lift up to you now those prayers residing in the silence of our hearts and minds. Where there is despair, grant hope. Where there is suffering, peace. Where there is doubt, grant assurance. And where there is great, great anxiety, grant our dependence on your enduring promises. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We offer all of these in the name of your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We now offer our gifts. If our ushers could come forward. And as we offer our gifts, we want to do so recognizing that this is a time when it's sign and symbol of how we really offer our lives onto God, onto the work of helping people experience the reality of Christ, helping people experience the reality of God's love as made real in Jesus Christ. Please stand. Reveal your compassion in our acts of love and generosity. bring into our lives those who are blinded by fear and guilt, so that they may know the reconciling power of your grace. Open our hearts to your will and to the pathways that you would have us walk, to reveal your love, reveal your kingdom, to help this world recognize that your Son abides with us and in us by the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Hear now a reading from Psalm 38, verse 15. For I am waiting for you, O Lord. You must answer for me, O Lord, my God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Hear now a reading from the Old Testament, Jeremiah 29, verses 11 through 13. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. In those days when you pray, I will listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It's always good to have baby Lennon here. Isn't it nice to hear the sound of a baby?
Yes.
I love it.
Yes. Space planet.
No, I love it. That's awesome. Trust me. Oh, Linda, was it something I said? You know, I tell you. Maybe she's opposed to babies. Who knows? No, Linda's great. Thank you. She's awesome. And I'll tell you about her when she leaves.
She doesn't.
This is the part of the service where it says pastor speaks, actually. Well, you know, one of the things that I have a great deal of difficulty with, I hate to wait. I literally cannot wait for anything, okay? And I've always been that way. But have you ever noticed that your entire life somebody's telling you, just wait and you'll be able to do what you want to do? Just wait, you know? I can remember when my mom was still with us and I had a horrible time ever getting a date, you know? And she said, don't worry, Tom, you just wait. You just wait and you'll find somebody to go to prom with you. So, you know, but Mom, I'm like 43 and it hasn't happened yet. And then, you know, it was always, well, you wait, you're going to find the right person you're going to want to spend your life with. And so when Roxanne and I met after we'd gone to high school together, and she, of course, ignored me for all 3 years. And then we met again, and I said to her at that time, I said, you know, do you think it's just coincidence that we met after all these years? Or is it true that if you just wait long enough, maybe the right person will come along? And she looked at me really sincerely and said, I'm just going to keep waiting. But you know, the reason, that's actually a true story, and that kind of hurt. But I'm not bitter. Don't think I'm bitter. The reason that we have such a hard time waiting, it's not because we think that waiting is a real problem. We have a hard time waiting because we want to define what's going to happen. We want to craft our world the way we want it to be. We want to make things turn out the way we think they should be. And in that regard, sometimes we even play God. And we say, you know what? This is what's going to happen in my life. I don't want to deal with what I'm dealing with. I don't want to deal with this problem. I don't want to deal with an illness. I don't want to deal with a relative that's giving us difficulty. I don't want to deal with all of the things that I have to deal with. And so we take the attitude, well, why don't we? So then people will say, well, just wait. Things will get better. And we don't want to do that. We don't want to wait. We live in a world of instantaneous gratification. You can go online, buy something, it'll be here later this afternoon. You can go online and look up any bit of information, whether it's true, false, invalid, whatever it is, and all of a sudden you've got your information that you somehow depend on. We live in a world of instantaneous gratification. We don't want to wait. Well, you know what? We are not alone. This is not simply part and parcel of this current generation. The Israelites did not want to wait either. You know, the passage that Jenny read from Jeremiah is the passage you see every graduation year. Oh, the Lord says, I have great plans for you. It's on coffee mugs, it's on graduation cards, it's on t-shirts, it's on banners. The reality is it's not talking about having great plans for you. It's talking about how God is going to be revealed in your life. That's what that message is all about. And the Israelites were in captivity in Babylon. They had been conquered, the temple destroyed, the center of religious life, and now they were in exile. And everybody reads that verse where God says to the prophet Jeremiah, I have great plans for you. That's verse 11. Nobody ever preaches on verse 10. Nobody. You know why? Because in verse 10, God tells the Israelites, you have to wait a long time. You have to wait a long time before you can go back and rebuild Jerusalem. You have to wait a long time. Most of you will be dead before you get to go home. That's the passage we don't preach on. Because the reality is, what God is basically saying is, it is time to wait. And it is time to wait with purpose and in prayer. Now, within the book of the prophet Jeremiah, we get some very specific advice about waiting. But I'm not really sure we can look back at the Israelites and say that's advice that we can use today. What I think we need to use today is we have to ask ourselves, what are we waiting for when it comes to God? What are we waiting for? And if I were to take a survey of everybody I know, including every pastor I work with, we would all come up with something that we want to change in our life. That's what we're waiting for. If we have a loved one suffering from a chronic, possibly life-limiting illness, we're waiting for God to heal that person. If we're dealing with a financial problem in our life, we're waiting for God to heal that. And you can see any one of a number of prosperity preachers on TV who tell you that God will heal that financial problem. All you've got to do is send in that seed gift. God will multiply it, and you'll be prosperous. I do have the seed gift envelopes available after the service, right? Not really. The fact is that we always say we're waiting for God to make our life better. We're waiting for God to make our life better in terms of the circumstances of our life. We're waiting for God to make our life somehow more prosperous, somehow more filled with the possessions we want, with the job we want, with the friends we want, with the house we want. We're waiting for God to do all of that. Here's the reality. God is waiting for us to listen to God's wisdom. God is waiting for us to listen to God's wisdom as to how to walk through this world. God is waiting for us to be open to God's wisdom as to how to navigate the issues we face in life. I know of a person who has gone through a lengthy battle with cancer. And I asked her the other day, how do you pray? How did you pray when you were diagnosed with cancer and you knew it was a very rare, aggressive form of cancer? I said, didn't you just pray for healing? I said, no. I said, you've never prayed for healing. She said, no, I've never prayed for healing. I said, did you ever pray, why me? Why did this happen to me and not someone else? I'm a good person. I go to church. I'm a faithful person. No, I never really prayed for. I never really raised that question with God. What did you pray for? She said, I prayed for answers. Answers as to what? Answers as to what treatment to take? Answers as to what to do? Answers as to what doctor to see? And she said, no, I prayed for God to answer me as to how he wanted me to walk this journey. And I had to wait for that answer. She said, I prayed because I had to wait for that answer because it's so easy to think that the answer you hear from God is actually the answer you want. The answer we hear from God is the answer that God wants in our life. And that's what we have to understand. Because in that answer, God's love is revealed. And so when we are waiting for God's wisdom, what do? That's hard. When we're waiting for the right answer, what do? Do we just sit back? See, waiting has developed a very bad connotation in our world. Waiting is a bad thing. It's like inaction, doing nothing, sitting around, waiting for the next shoe to drop, waiting for money to fall out of the sky, waiting for something good to happen. But we don't have to do anything. That's not waiting for God's wisdom. Waiting for God's wisdom implies three very important things. First of all, is our heart really open to receive it? Do you really want God to direct your life? Or do you want God just to take direction from you? Do you really want God to direct your life? The Israelites had to ask themselves that question. You got a long wait in Babylon, the prophet says. You really want God to direct your life? Oh, God will restore Jerusalem. God will restore the great nation of Israel. But do you really want to wait? Do you really want God to direct your life? So first, we have to be open to God's direction in our life, not our direction to God. Secondly, we have to be open to true prayer, which means we have to center ourselves in God. We have to center ourselves in God's love. We have to center ourselves in God's word. We have to be open to true prayer. And the other thing we need to do in purposeful waiting, we need to surround ourselves with things that give us life while we're waiting for God's wisdom. We need to surround ourselves with things that give us life while waiting for God's wisdom in our life. Because those life-giving things in our life, relationships, friendships, churches, faith, prayer, gathering, whatever it is, they open us deeper and deeper to God's grace. So when we talk about waiting, when we talk about waiting for God, let's not think about waiting for God to do what we want. Let's think about waiting for God to tell us what God wants to do with our life. And in that sense, just like the prophet Jeremiah said to the Israelites centuries and centuries ago, if we get that answer of what God wants to do in our life, then God has good plans for each of us. Let us pray. Holy God, we come today to you as a people in waiting. But we are waiting for you to open our hearts to the path you would have us walk in this world. A path that will reveal your love, a path that will witness the beauty of knowing that Christ is present to us through your Spirit, a path that will allow us to testify and witness to the world that Jesus Christ is real, life-transforming, life-changing, reconciling us unto you. We pray that as we wait, we will do so with hearts open to your wisdom. We pray that as we wait, we will do so with a constant attitude of prayer. We pray that as we wait, we will fill our lives with those things that give us true life, not possessions, position, or power, but those relationships that bring us life, that bring us hope, that cause us to rejoice as we know your promises are real, and we can trust you for all eternity. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
It's very interesting because as Jenny read from the prophet, because he starts out and it's a very sad, sad picture of what's happened in this time of lament and all things are bad. And then all of a sudden we get into chapter 29 of the book of Jeremiah. And he starts talking about how you have to live joyfully and purposely, even though you're in exile. Talking about getting married, get married, celebrate, build a house, plant a garden, plant a vineyard. And then he goes into the next chapters and talks about being a celebratory people. Because that's also part of waiting, waiting with joy. And one of the ways we wait with joy for God's wisdom in our life is at this meal. And it is far more than simply coming to a table, going through a ritual. This is coming into God's grace in a very special way. It's coming into God's grace in a way that nurtures us, just as we are nurtured by food. It is coming to God's grace in a way that strengthens us, sustains us, and restores us. And today, as on any day, we need that restoration and that sustenance. So please, please join me in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread in his sacred hands. He gave you thanks. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples as he gives it to each of you this morning, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, calling them by name, even the one who would betray him, saying, "Take and drink from this, each one of you. This is the cup of my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. And each time you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as we prepare to celebrate this sacred meal, we gather together those concerns of our life, those times we have fallen short, those times we have failed to reveal God's love. We join together in the perfect prayer that our Lord and Savior gave us. As the good people of Salem United Methodist Church say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The table has been set, the invitation has been given. All are welcome to come and participate.
Please join me in the closing prayer, which can be found in your bulletin. Almighty God,
this day we have gathered in celebration of your mighty word. In song, in prayer, and in the words of our lips and the meditations of our hearts, we are rejoiced that we depend on your promises as revealed and fulfilled in your Son, our Lord. Through the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, send us forth to wait with joy and to be a people of the Incarnation, so that all people may experience your grace through your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join us in our closing hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, page 133.
Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, leaning.
Well, thank you all so much. And it's so cool to see baby Lennon walking. That's awesome. Next week, she can light the candles. It's so nice to be with all of you today. As I mentioned, as you heard in our prayers, this has been a challenging week for our Salem family. But yet, it is so wonderful that we can come together and we are here for one another. And that's what makes this place so special. That's what makes being part of Salem so special for each and every one of us. And Roxanne and I are richly blessed to call this our church family and to be here. And so I want to thank you, Jenny, for a wonderful job as liturgist, Donna and Adam for the music, Penny for the camera and the food delivery service this morning. Penny was hauling in boxes of pancakes and orange juice and everything else early this morning, so we appreciate that. And as we close, it is my blessing to ask us all to remember God's blessing. And you know, the greatest blessing we truly have from God is in Jesus Christ. Because in Jesus Christ, God guides us. God gives us a way to live and a certain wisdom by God's Spirit. And when we go out into the world, our primary task is to help people know that Jesus Christ is real, that Jesus Christ is there, that we can abide in Christ alone. And so may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ touch and transform each of our hearts. May the love of God protect and surround you in all ways. And may every step you take, every breath you take, every decision you make be done in full communion with God's Holy Spirit. Let us go in peace. Let us wait for the right answer from God. And let us wait with joy. Because we can say without question, we are a people loved by God.
May we live as a sign to the world of God's love.
Our special music today, and those of you who may not realize this, I'm a big fan of Chris Tomlin. Donna knows if she ever mentions a Chris Tomlin song, we're going to go with it. Just beautiful, beautiful work that bridges contemporary and traditional music within the church, which I think is very important to do. So today, our special music to conclude is called Gifts from God. And as you listen to this, think of the gift from God that is God's wisdom in your life. What a wonderful, wonderful gift.